Ooh. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Today we're going to be playing Farnham Fables, Episode 1, The King's Medicine. And some of you might be wondering, oh, why did you play this game? Well, it totally didn't have anything to do with, oh, that one. The naked lizard lady on the There, okay, back to the game. But with that out of the way, let's get going. And episode one, The King's Medicine. Episode one, The King's Medicine, written by Andrew Tolini. A light drizzle of rain accompanies young Nayaki and her little niece Callie as they make their way to the castle where Callie's father, Mitsurugi, works as a high-ranking soldier for the king's personal army. Earlier in the week, Mitsurugi had promised his daughter a visit to the castle, but when an unexpected guard duties arose, he demanded his sister take her there instead. Nayaki agreed, more from her timid nature and feelings of family obedience than a desire to visit the castle. But seeing Callie so cheerful and enthusiastic made things easier for her. Well, emotionally at least. Callie, please don't jump in the puddles, Nagi once again has to remind the energy-filled three-year-old rat girl. Callie is too busy humming to herself to give a response. By rat girl? Do they mean, like, really ugly? Or, like, legit a rat girl? Are we gonna find out? I wonder. You know what else I noticed about this window? Is it's not center. Like, look how big this space is, and look how small this space is. Why? Why? Callie is too busy humming to herself to give a response until they are close enough to see the castle. Aini, Naiji, Aini! Look, is the ca cas is the castle! Callie excitedly exclaims. Yes, Miss Callie, slow down, please, Nagi replies as she tightens her hold on Callie's hand to keep her from running ahead. Aini, Nainji, is Dad gonna be there? No, Callie responds gently with only a faint hint of frustration. I told you, Daddy won't be here today. He has to guard the Queen because she needs to visit her sick brother. Why is he sick? I don't know, Callie. Why don't you know? Callie interrupts. I don't know, because it's a private family matter, Callie. Nagi's tone is gentle, though a little more from feeling tired than from her loving patience. Ooh, Callie briefly quiets down, more from her mind wandering to other things than from being satisfied with the answer. They reach the castle gates, where two friendly guards greet them and politely escort them to the main entrance hall, asking that they wait for somebody to give them a tour of the castle. But Callie has other ideas in mind. Look, talk, give, take, touch. Doll. Look at doll. Callie's Freya doll was lovingly made by her Aunt Nayagi, although Nagi's. Aunt. Yes, that's what niece means. I'm. For some reason in my head, when it said niece, like Callie was Nagi's niece, I thought that Nagi was Callie's older sister. Good job, me. Although Nagi's lack of doll-making experience quickly, it clearly shows. Callie treasures it more than anything else she owns. Aw, that's sweet. Callie. Kalanique Issa, better known as Callie, is full of energy and excitement as usual and doesn't really want to be around here. So look at door. With Nagi in the way, Callie isn't even able to secretly check if the door is locked or not. Callie's disappointment, the door is locked. She wonders if it means. So Rayleigh's out of the castle. Okay, what about this? Look at painting. It's a beautiful painting done by the host of some TV show that Nagi sometimes watches, but Callie finds really boring. King Farnham must be a fan of the show as well. So this is a weird world where there's still kings, but there's lots of TV.
I guess there's kings in the world now. Okay, so this is the only one that's lit up. Look at the unlocked door. It appears that this door is unlocked. Callie really wants to know what's on the other side. Okay, so how do I get there? It looks the only one that. Maybe. I can't, like, go. Give Callie to doll. Callie's doll coming to life and carrying around would probably be more scary than funny if it could. So what happens if I give doll to Callie? Nothing happened. That's right. Just click on go. Finding the door unlocked, Callie cheerfully pushes it open and runs laughing down the hallway. Talanique Issa, you get back here, Maggie cries out, more from fear than anger, as she quickly runs after her naughty niece. Little rascal's going for it. Neither get very far, though, as who should stand before them but none other than King Ferdinand Farnham himself. Why, hello there, little one, King Farnham exclaims as he lifts up the energetic Callie. You must be the daughter of my fine soldier, Mitsurugi Issa, aren't you? I'm Cowie, Callie laughingly responds. Then hello, Callie. And this must be your poor Auntie Niagi over here. King Farnham smiles at Niagi, who, while still in shock, is unable to respond more than a fearful little squeak. How wonderful to have you come visit my castle today. I'm in the mood for a story. Let me tell you about something wonderful my sons did for me. Just recently. King Farnham leaves into the royal throne room, hangs up the raincoats, and takes a seat with Callie happily in his lap. This is a nice king. He motions towards the king's royal throne and says, Come, have a seat in my wife's chair, dear. Niagi, make yourself comfortable.
Ooh.
Niagi cautiously takes a seat on the queen's throne, unused to such friendly hospitality and more from the king himself, of all people. Even amazing, as King Farnham begins to tell a story, Callie actually settles down and pays attention. No. When it was? Yes. It was 10 days ago. That's right. When I developed a dreadful fever. It was nothing a few days of troubled bed rest couldn't cure, but my sons, oh, such loving children, they couldn't bear to see me suffering. Well, it just so happens then, collects to, that the village of native lizard people, just off the highway, there lives a brilliant doctor who, well, as they did in fact find out, could brew a potion capable of curing my fever within seconds. Okay, so this is a world with, like, feudal kings, lizard people, potions, and TV. Let's just... Okay. Okay, I just want to make sure we're on the same scene. So, my three wonderful children rode off on their horses to the nearest bus station. Okay. So, they also have buses. What? Because it was faster and more efficient to take the bus than simply ride their steeds the whole way there. Ha 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 ha. Ha. What the heck is this world? King Farnham continues to tell Niagi and Callie a simplified version of the story, but you, dear viewer, shall get to see all what happened with the three princes, Frederick, Fludor, and Philip. Okay, so Philip doesn't want to carry Fludor, nor would he be able to. Okay, Fludor never really had to carry Philip around, but he wouldn't want to carry adult Philip around. Okay, so Frederick doesn't want to dance on the bench. Go to the forest. There isn't any time to check out the forest. Go to the bus stop. Go across the highway. There's no time or reason to go across the highway besides people like to seem to be driving like yahoos today. So even more disobedience and stay off the road. Okay. So we're going to a village. What the heck kind of world is this? Go to the doctor's hut. Was that naked man? Frederick and Fludor enter the doctor's hut, but upon sight of the doctor, Philip stays in the doorway. Although he was anticipating the villagers to wear very little, he wasn't expecting the doctor to be wearing practically nothing at all. Hey, good karma upon all of you. Welcome, outsiders, the friendly doctor says. Oh, I need to find another voice. Hang on. I think I have one. You can call me Dr. Keith, man. It's all good. So what brings you hip humans to my humble home?
Greetings, Dr. Keith, Friedrich says.
Friedrich says, not really bothered by his lack of clothing.
I am Prince Friedrich of Farnham. All of these are my brothers, Fludor and Philip.
I need another voice.
Our father is very sick, Fludor adds painfully. If possible, we wish to shorten the length of time he would need in order to regain his health. My older brother claims you may know of a cure. Is this true?
Oh man, you guys, said Dr. Heath. What a total bummer to hear the king's not feeling the good vibes he so richly deserves. But wow, to come out all this way to help your father like that. Totally good karma, man.
Now let me look here, Dr. Heath says, searching through his medical supplies. Bummer, man. I have everything I need except this one mushroom here. Showing the brother's picture in a book.
Why are they naked?
But it's like in the forest, nobody's allowed in there right now because the terrible monster's like wrecking the peace and harmony of the forest, man.
Dude, I chose the perfect voice for this. I did not know it was going to fit so well.
That won't be a problem for us, Fludor says. And besides, whatever monster we may face will be no match for my older brother, Friedrich, in response, simply nods and smiles.
Oh man, you guys, Dr. Heath responds, tearing up a little. You truly love your father, man. Alright, I'll give everything else ready here while you're gone. Godspeed, noble princes.
Okay, let's leave. As the three princes start to leave the village, a woman's voice suddenly calls out to them.
Wait! A panic lizard woman cries out.
Briefly starting her a little, but also causing her to blush a little. I swear to you, dear Rachel, we will find your daughter Gloria and bring her back safely from the forest, Friedrich says, his gentle voice full of confidence, his brothers not in agreement, knowing their father will more than understand their delay.
Thank you,
Rachel whispers as Friedrich gently brings her arm around her in a comforting hug. Fludor and Philip wait patiently while Friedrich continues to hug Rachel, comforting her until her eyes are no longer filled with tears. Tired to wait at home, Rachel waits by the village entrance as the princes get ready to go. Hug Keith. I guess I should probably ask them. Where exactly in the forest should we be looking, Friedrich asks.
Oh, he is there, everywhere, man, Dr. Keith. This mushroom likes to hide with other mushrooms that look similar, but like, aren't at all what you're looking for.
You mentioned some sort of danger in the forest right now, Friedrich asks.
Oh yeah, man, Dr. Keith responds. There's this big monster down the piece of the forest, man. It's like...
Okay. Done talking. Back. We'll leave. Go to the forest. Search. Searching stump same symbol. Okay, should we go left or right? Hang on.
Hang on a sec. I'll be back.
Okay, I know how to solve this. We're gonna ask Siri. Left is heads, right is tails. Hang on a sec. We will ask Google. Heads or tails? What is Google going to say? Flipping, flip it. Oh, tails. Okay, so we're going right. Right. Go up the path. Fox, look at the fox. That's floating. Yeah, that fox looks really sick. Maybe Philip can do something to help it. Philip, switch to Philip. Look at the fox. Talk to fox. Pet fox. Okay, phone. You want to not do that right there? Thank you. Philip considers comforting the fox, but maybe actually tending it to it would be better. Tend to fox. Philip can tell there's something wrong with the fox and believes he has the right medicine to make him feel better. Thanks to his ability to communicate with animals, Philip was able to convince the fox to trust him and take some medicine from his medical kit. The fox immediately begins to feel better. Friedrich and Fludu wait while Philip continues to communicate with the fox until he returns with them. That poor thing, he nibbled on some mushrooms to see if they were safe, but they gave him a terrible tummy ache. I'm glad you were able to help the fox out, Fludor says, plainly but sincerely. Oh, that's not all, Philip continues. I told him about our search for Gloria, and he says he could help us find her. Maybe bring him something with her scent. Do you remember if Rachel said that Gloria brought anything in the forest with her? Perhaps we could find something. Switch to Fludor. Fludor has a book, and Friedrich has a sword. Mushrooms. Look at the mushrooms. It's a bunch of mushrooms, meaning there's a very good chance one they're looking for is here. Cake? Mushrooms. Good idea. Only Friedrich can't find the exact mushroom they need. Fludor would be able to find the right one, though. Okay, Fludor. What you can do is study these mushrooms. I do believe the mushroom seek they found here, Fludor allowed me to take a closer look. Using his book as a reference, Fludor searched through the thing while his brother patiently waited. I do believe I found it, Fludor says, picking one of the mushrooms. Wonderful, says Friedrich. Now let's continue our search for Gloria. Okay. Swim in the lake. Fludor's decent, but would rather not go swimming than this needs to. What about Philip? Does Philip want to swim? Really not time for any swimwear. Look at this. Oh, dude. Philip. Friedrich is such a ladies man. Wait. Oh, so it's just one big circle. Okay, so let's go back to the lady, talk, kiss. Oh. You're very beautiful. Okay, so let's ask, Philip is the one that can talk today. Climb the wall. talk to Rachel. Okay, so it was just a few minutes ago, Rachel responded. I was telling her we couldn't go to the forest today, and then I saw Heather passing by, so I waved and said hello. Rachel sighs and then continues, isn't this the first time Rachel's been off like this, but she has a guard to catch her. But today they're in a meeting about something dangerous in the forest right now. Okay, can we... Buildings. Looks... Okay, so let's go ask, please get dressed. Okay, so you want to get dressed. Okay, so we'll give mushroom to that. Far out, man, Dr. Heath exclaimed. You got the mushroom. Truly outrageous. I can have a mess or anything. Just a minute. Have a seat and shot for a spell. You guys earned it. Actually, Fludor says, we're also in the middle of looking for a lost little girl. I just wanted to drop off the mushroom first so you could start getting probably. Oh man, I'm so bummed out to hear that, Keith replies sadly, and then perks up. Hey, cheer up, man. Good karma's coming your way. I know you'll find your savings out, man. I can feel it deep in my heart. Godspeed, noble prince. Prince leaves the doctor's hut with no intention of returning until after. Oh my god. I need to ask him if I go to someone else. Hang on, let me just. I don't know. Okay. Let's just hope that doesn't happen again. Okay, so let's go back to the forest, go to the lake, and bushes, look at bushes. So, and the bushes on the vent, Friedrich. The bushes. There's something hiding in the bushes. Search. Bushes. There's something in Friedrich takes another look. Friedrich finds what appears to be a small skirt of native fashion, though unusually designed for a child. You don't suppose this belongs to Gloria, Friedrich asks. Or Friedrich says, well, you don't suppose this belongs to Gloria, Friedrich says, while taking the skirt out of the opening. Philip, meanwhile, gets a horrified expression at the thought of what finding this could possibly mean. There's no sign of struggle or energy, Fludor says, noticing Philip's concern. I have a theory. Perhaps she took it off to go swimming. Perhaps something frightened her into running, and she merely left it behind. Philip feels much better, believing that Gloria must be okay, only to instead become embarrassed at the thought of her running around naked somewhere. In case, Friedrich says, this is certainly something that the fox should be able to get Gloria sent from and lead us to her. So, I totally didn't go look up a playthrough to figure that out or anything. I figured it out all on my own, and the skip was totally not suspicious. So we need to give the clothing to Fox. Great idea, but the fox struck Philip more. Oh, I need to give, give clothing to Philip, and we got Philip, and give clothing to Fox. Picking up Gloria's scent from the skirt, the fox quickly runs to the southeast, obviously expecting the prince to follow. That way? That way? That way? That way? There. The fox gives the princes a confused look, wondering why they chose to go the long way around. The princes were surprised to find it has cleared away a bush, revealing a clearing. Oh, thank you ever so much, kind fox, Philip says, and then turning to his brothers, he says that Gloria is through here, hiding behind that really tall tree. Frederick feels a little embarrassed that he wasn't able to find the clearing himself. Suddenly, the fox looks startled, as if sensing danger somewhere. The fox runs off, Phyllis comes out. Oh, goodbye, kind fox. I hope everything's okay. So where is this clearing? Search Friedrich. Going to the clearing. As soon as the three princes enter in the clearing, they find Gloria behind a large tree. Hey, you're not monsters, you're humans, Gloria says happily. Thank you, I think you mean humans, Fodor says, smiling a little. Mommy says I couldn't come in here because of the monsters, but I saw the monsters and he was scary, so I ran away and he couldn't find me because I was hiding. Well, your mother wants you to come home now, and she'll probably want to give you a big hug because she was very worried about you. Okay, Gloria, clearly wanting to be picked up and carried. Suddenly, a large wild boar comes charging in, guarding the only exit. Ah, the monster! Gloria cries out, covering her face with her hands. The boar looks ready to charge, its focus entirely on Gloria. Swing sword at boar. With fierce determination in his eyes, Friedrich gets between Gloria and the wild boar, his sword steady and strong in his left hand. Oh, he's a lefty. Gross. More. Be gone, you monster, or feel my sting. Friedrich commands the boar, his firm voice powerful and unshaken. But there's no fear to be found in the boar's hate-filled eyes. With little warning, it suddenly charges straight at Friedrich. Clang. Although Friedrich's sword isn't sharp, a well-aimed swing can hurt like the dickens. With tears of pain in his eyes, the wild boar retreats back in the forest, now completely terrified of the strength and bravery of the valiant prince. Yay, Gloria cheers. You made the monster go foom. You're a human hero. Aha, I'm glad you're okay, Gloria. Now let's bring you back home. Friedrich says, happily picking up Gloria and tickling her. Gloria laughs out loud, cheerfully. The potentially traumatic experience, now just a fun, happy moment. Let's give the clothing back to Friedrich, and we'll give clothing to Gloria. Gloria doesn't want to get dressed, which makes Friedrich happy and feels embarrassed. Fludor doesn't really care either way. Okay, so let's leave, and we'll go find a fox, maybe. Oh well. We'll go back, and we'll go to the village. As they near the village, Gloria suddenly runs ahead as Rachel notices them. Mommy, mommy, I saw the monster, and Prince Friedrich made the monster, he go, boom. Gloria, Rachel exclaims, immediately picking up Gloria for a hug. Oh dear, Gloria, please, please, please don't ever run away like that ever again. I was so worried. I won't, Gloria responds unconvincingly.
She's a little shit. I think she's gonna run away again.
Oh, Gloria, you lost the little skirt I made you too, Rachel says with a hint of frustration. Oh, no, she didn't. Friedrich responds, handing Rachel the skirt. She didn't want to wear it, which was absolutely fine with me. Here you go. Oh, really? Rachel laughs a little with amusement. Well, Mommy wants everyone to see the cute little skirt she made for you, Gloria. Come over here, sweetie. Although she clearly doesn't want to, Gloria stands still long enough for Rachel to put up the skirt back on her. Thank you again, oh, so much, Rachel says. I can't thank you enough. Without speaking a word, Friedrich walks over to Rachel and gives her a hug. Unsurprisingly, Rachel hugs back in response, and Gloria joins in as well. Whenever you're ready, Fludor says, we should get that medicine from Dr. Keith. My apologies, sweet Rachel, Friedrich says while disengaging the hug, but Fludor is right. We came here for some medicine to help our father recover his health. I promise you both I will come back, perhaps even tomorrow.
Dude, Friedrich is a player.
Oh, I understand. Rachel responds with slight disappointment. Thank you again so much, and I hope King Farnham feels better. Okay, so we go to the doctor's hut. Upon returning to the doctor's hut, Friedrich and Fludor tell the doctor all about rescuing Gloria, while Philip again waits in the doorway.
Most righteous, Dr. Keith exclaims. You guys are bee's knees, man. Tell you what, this medicine? Free of charge, man.
No, I won't hear otherwise, man. Karma's telling me you guys deserve it.
Having finished with the medicine, Dr. Keith hands the bottle over to Friedrich.
Thank you again so much, Dr. Keith, Friedrich says, bowing.
Hey man, no prob, says Dr. Keith. Stop by any time you need some good vibes or just feel like shooting the breeze. Godspeed, noble prince.
Okay, so now we can leave and go back to the bus stop. And bus, look at the bus, ride the bus. Three princes get back on the bus and ride back to the station where they had left their horses parked and quickly ride to the castle. Friedrich was the first to my bedside, King Farnham says, smiling, but Fludor and Philip arrive in time to see me drink that wonderful medicine, which tasted like cherries, I might add. The result was so immediate, I thought at first it was but a dream. Oh shoot, I clicked.
Turns out that both right and left click will, switch to the next scene.
Friedrich was the first to my bedside, King Farnham said with a smile, but Fludor and Philip arrived in time to see me drink that wonderful medicine, which tastes like cherries, I might add.
Oh, no.
Right click goes back one.
Oh.
King Farnham, Callie asked, having been completely silent to now. Is that too story? King Farmhand asks a little and says, "Dear Callie, I promise to you that is a story that is real as you and I. The proof is in the present, and I always say, and you don't see me suffering from a nasty fever now, do you?" "No," Callie responds, still hanging on to King Farnham's every word. Nagi has even forgotten her nervousness in the presence of the king, or the presence of the king, and she too had a wonderful time listening to his story. "Oh dear me, is that the time?" King Farnham says as he checks his watch. "I do apologize, but it completely slipped my mind that I have a meeting with the royal advisor in 17 minutes. I do hope you understand." "Oh, thank you again, Your Majesty," Nagi says pleasantly, as though she was speaking to an old friend. We also have errands we need to finish up today as well, and thank you again for that wonderful story." Bidding the king a fond farewell, the happy young aunt and her carefree little niece put on their raincoats before leaving the castle and heading for home, the story still fresh in their mind. Especially Callie's, as she babbles on about her favorite parts of the story the entire walk, Maggie simply smiles and nods, happy their visit to the castle went far better than she ever could have imagined. Aww. Hope you enjoyed this story, dear viewer. Well, I did. I thought it was a good story. I'm going to leave it here. I'll come back for the rest of them. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys again next time. Bye-bye.